Tim Myhole. I look forward to speaking with you today. My topic today is finding ways to score in search of offense. Probably a little bit different. It's not specific on one little element of the game. It's really about attacking the ring from 200 feet. And just a little bit about this subject. It's interesting for me. When I took over in Philadelphia, the year I took over midseason, we were the worst team in the league. And I took some time that year at the end of the year just to research the top offensive teams in the league and look for tendencies. Back then, believe it or not, it was teams like Ottawa and Buffalo that were the best offensive teams in the league. So what I was looking for is, okay, what do they do? What tendencies, aside from personnel, aside from having very good players, what are the tendencies that allow them to have success and score more than we are? I mean, we had to get better in a lot of areas. We were looking for some structure to implement into our game. And it really helped us get better as an offensive team. When I went to Los Angeles, we had a lot of success, won two cups while I was there, and it was largely due to the fact that we were really good defensively. We had a great goalie in Jonathan Quick. But we were always under pressure there to score more. We had to find ways to score more. And I did an exercise there that I'll share with you today that I also did this year in Dallas. And just breaking down the way other teams score, where their offense comes from, and what are the tendencies that perhaps we can take advantage of. So we won two cups, but nobody's going to argue the fact that we had to do more with defense than it did offense. That study really helped us. We went from 201 or 202 goals to 239 the following year, and I'll talk a little bit more about that later on. Ironically, I joined the Dallas Stars this year, and our team was much the same. Very good defensive team, two really good goalies in Coben and Bishop, but a team that struggled to score enough goals in relation to the rest of the teams in the National Hockey League. So I set out on a little bit of a research project during the pause this year, something I did when I was in LA, and I just tracked certain teams that scored more than we did. I like the way they played, and where's the offense coming from? So I'm going to show you lots of video today on other teams, a little bit of Dallas, but more on other teams and tendencies. And hopefully target some fundamentals that you can teach at any level that are important to be in a better offensive team. And I'm going to share some drills, some of my favorites. I know we all got great drills, and you guys probably have better drills than me. But I'll share some of the drills as it relates to all those areas and how we try to work on things to get better. So first thing I'd like to look at is just share this experiment that I've done. And it looks like a lot of numbers. There's an explanation off to the side of what each category means, but what we did was we looked at our team. This year, all the goals scored up until the pause in the NHL season. So these are all the regular season goals scored. And we looked at teams in our division, Colorado, St. Louis, and we also looked at two teams in the Pacific Division. Those are the teams you're going to face. We like the way they play defensively. So we try to target, so what are they doing in these areas that we can do better? So if you eliminate the bottom, so if you take this area here, this is really special teams, 4-on-4, 3-on-3, special situations, infinite goals. Let's get rid of that and focus on the 5-on-5. And if you look up to the left, this area on the left, that's all stuff scored off the rush. What this means is the plays that originate out of your own zone are the D-zone. D-zone exit transition. So traditionally, pucks chipped in, your team breaks it out. You're able to go down the ice and score at the other end, or you break up a play. That would be more transition, where you blocked the shot, you went down and scored. But either way, both those plays are coming out of your zone, and then neutral zone would be the same. Either it was a checking situation that you turned into a rush goal for, or it was a control where you were, whether it was a face-off, line change, where you had possession of the puck, you were in an organized look, and you went down and scored off the rush. So as you can see, 53 goals, not enough compared to some of these other teams. Neutral zone was an area that obviously, we fell behind significantly that I think we need to be a lot better at, so let's take a look at that. And the big thing for me was the ozone. So if you just look at these numbers here, ozone play would be time in the zone where you had possession for a long period of time. Ozone forecheck would be any of those situations where the puck got turned over and you scored shortly after that. From that turnover, it might have been they got possession, were leaving the zone, and you checked them off the puck, but those are checking situations and obviously face-offs. And that was the category that really interested me because we've got a big, strong team in Dallas. We've got some talented players. I just felt like we shouldn't be trailing Vegas and St. Louis by that big a number in a forechecking situation. So we want to look at it. So what are they doing consistently? What are the tendencies? What do they do well? What are some of the things that maybe we can get better at? So those are the areas I want to look at with you today and hopefully pinpoint some fundamental areas that we can all get better at regardless of the level that we're playing at. So, D-zone exits is the first one we'll look at. And quite honestly, when you look at the D-zone exits, a lot of teams have a similar structure. But I just want to pinpoint some things on these teams and also on the way we play. So, first area is the first touch by your defenseman. I think retrievals is something you got to work on all the time. This picture right here could probably paint a picture for every team in the league. You've got a dot line center support to the puck. You've got a guy on the wall that you're expecting to make a play. This guy's going to push the D off the line either on a steep route, a middle route, or a slant route. And everybody in the league now is activating that backside defenseman to create a number on the rush. The other fundamental that I want you guys to focus on is right there. Teams that are good offensively enter the offensive zone. They've got a dot line support to the puck right on that dot line trying to 2-on-1 that defenseman. They've got all three lanes filled going to the net. Teams do a really good job of finishing their routes and stopping at the net. So just look at what we just talked about. There's your first touch by your defenseman. There's your close support. Touch the defenseman and touch the puck first. He can immediately join and play off the puck, and he creates a number on the rush. You look at the score, it's a 2-2 hockey game with 9 minutes to go. Just good fundamental hockey. The other thing we noticed on these first touches is how tight the defensemen are. A lot of teams will put those defensemen in the same corner. What happens now is this forecheck has got further to go. Instead of this defenseman being out here, he's right inside that dot line, which buys time for that defenseman to make a play. And the other thing, and we preach this all the time, we did in LA, we do in Dallas, you want that centerman going right through the blue paint. So even though that wall is covered, you have an outlet in the middle of the ice. The other thing we'll talk about lots today is just puck protection. And I think it's a key staple to a good offensive team and a good offensive player. I think St. Louis is the best in the league. A lot of teams would attack this way, try and get the net here. You watch St. Louis. They want to get inside this guy. They try and get into his space so they can control that space and put this guy in his back. Just like that. It's a great job by Steen. He gets the play to the net. This still would go under a D-zone exit category because this all came from a play leaving the zone that shortly thereafter ended up in the net. Vegas is another team. I'm looking at the first touch here. Again, this nice little triangle support, but it's this first touch. It's this close support. Allows it to trap that early pressure. And it's just a quick, easy exit that ends up in a rush play off on a good play out of your zone and a puck in the back of the net. The thing I would ask you as coaches is how much activation are you comfortable with? Another area that we need to be aware of as coaches is just this play on the wall. This play, nothing happens leaving your zone if players can't make this play on the wall. So they get a good five-man support. And Vegas is clearly counting on this guy to make a play because this is the guy who touched the puck first. He's now leaving the zone. If that puck turned over, are you okay with that? And that would be my question to you as coaches. They are. He leaves the zone because he's counting on that guy down low to make a play. He ends up scoring the goal. That's Holden made the first touch below the goal line. Looking at Colorado, same concept. D-man first touch. See how tight he is inside the dot. He's not getting wide. Here's your low centerman. He's going through the blue paint. That was a quick play off the rush. Colorado is probably the best team that I saw on the rush. And look at that structure, just like St. Louis. They've got a dot line support on the entry. They got all three lanes filled. They got a defenseman up on the rush. Just good fundamental execution, and they always have a guy going through stopping at the net. Those plays on the wall, whether it's coming in your zone or it's the first play, if you watch Perron here, just the way he protects the puck, gets into the guy's hands, keeps the guy in his back, it sets up the whole play, and they always have people finishing through at the net, which makes it look like an easy goal. So this whole idea about a play on a wall to a dot line support guy, we have duplication and coverage. Nothing happens off this play. If O'Reilly can't protect the puck and make a play, there's your dot line support, there's your width of the ice, and there's your easy goal at the other end from a goalie, from a play a goalie touch. This last one here, again, just the importance of making that play on the wall. This McCarr is just a terrific young defenseman. Nothing happens on this play if that guy doesn't make that play. When you bring the guy to him, he makes a play forward, and there's no hesitation for the activation of the defenseman. It just ends up being a great play at the other end of the rink. And now we're just looking at Vancouver, the other team we looked at. Again, if defenseman nice and tight. We call this triangle support down low. Something we work on every day. Now this has been less time in our zone. Puck goes to a wall. Now we're counting on Pearson. We had Pearson in LA, great young player. Now he makes that play. He's got it right on the dot line. There's your width of the ice. There's your play of the backside. And there's your guy finishing at the net. So really good stuff. With the Stars is something we believe in as well. If I could tell you something about the Stars and the reason we looked at this, we do a lot of good things. I think our plan is really good. We got Klingberg, who you see here, makes a lot of good plays leaving the zone. Heiskanen, another one, Lindell. We have guys that are really good activating on the rush. We just think from a consistency basis, we have to do a better job. There's Klingberg. We get a turnover. He's going. Garionov, great young player for us this year. There's the width of the ice. There's a guy going through the net, and there's an easy goal going in the net. So, in terms of the structure of what we're doing, in terms of the plan of what we're doing, I think it's very similar for a lot of teams. What we try to do is focus on what are the fundamentals that we need to be really good at. If we're going to excel in this area and do more as an offensive team under these situations. For me, it was the first touch and support with the defenseman below the goal line. It's your low center support. And it's your ability to make a play on the wall to allow us to play fast. You can be fast, or you can play fast. I think all those things have to be in place in order to play fast. We'll share a couple of drills with you we use to work on this. I can just show it to you here and walk you through it. It's drawn out how it starts here, and I'll tell you the keys in the drill. So you have the defenseman in each opposite end of the ring with pucks. You have the forward in all four corners of the blue line, and the drill would start with a defenseman at net front here. The defenseman from the far end up, ready to defend a 2-on-1. This defenseman in the corner, he's going to gap up on the whistle. Sorry. He's going to back away, and his partner's going to spot him a puck. He's going to work in exchange with the defenseman in net front. He can drop off here. He can run a reverse. He can yell a wheel. But the defenseman that gapping up is always joining the rush. He's a support guy through net front. He's a support guy with his partner. We have the forwards always work back inside the dock. We find that if our forwards work dodge first, much more difficult for defense to pinch. We can make direct plays. They can roll to the wall. You can even put this puck on the wall if you want it so they can roll into it. But either way, you've got a 2-on-1, which really amounts to a 3-on-1 with that defenseman joining the rush. So now they're going to finish far end of the ring. 2-on-1 going out against that defenseman. And a lot of times that defenseman can be one of those guys going to the net. You want to have him active. You want to have him up the ice. Third guy who's coming in, it might be a defenseman, might be a forward. Play it out off the net. When the whistle goes, this defenseman's gapping up, he's going back, forwards are out of the way. The defenseman that received the rush, he is now working that exchange with these guys working in the zone. And the defenseman that joined the rush is now defending the play going back the other way. Really good drill for all those elements on breakouts. You can progress this drill to a 3-on-2. The only thing that would change, obviously, is you'd have your centerman come in with those two forwards, and 2D would be joining on every play. So we do it a lot 2-on-1. We do it occasionally 3-on-2, but either way, it has a lot of elements that can help you get better in that area. Another drill we do, what I try to do a lot, and I'm sure you coaches do, is I try to do a drill that's going to have not a lot of resistance, good puck movement, then I want to get some resistance, make them operate under pressure. So this drill as well goes 2-on-1. And then 3-on-2. So to start the drill, you just have two guys attack up ice 2-on-1. And have them play it out to your liking. On the whistle, everybody's on the move. So this forward is reloading out of the zone. There would be two pucks spotted at the red line as soon as the rush goes by. So the first guy picks the puck up, moves in on a breakaway. The second guy out of the zone would pick up the second puck and turn back, and the defenseman would have been gapping up on that forward leaving the zone. This forward is now going to chip that puck into the zone. This defenseman has to go back and get it. These forwards are going to fold into the zone. And they're going to break a puck out against pressure. That forward is only forechecking to the tops of the circles in terms of the puck leaving the zone. Then he would drop out of the way. It would be that same 2-on-1, 3-on-1 look heading up the ice. As soon as they go by, he would spot two more pucks, and that drill would run end-to-end. What would change, when you go to the 3-on-2 part of the drill, obviously there's a 3-on-2 that starts the drill. On the whistle, the first guy would go down on a breakaway, as you see here. The second guy would pick up the puck and get ready to dump it in. The third guy would tag up. He would be forechecking. That defenseman going back for the puck. this guy would work the middle ice, and he would put pressure on that first play out of the zone. So you get a little bit of resistance on the exchange with the defenseman. You have a little bit of resistance on that first play being made, so they have to read their options, whether the wall is open, net front D is open, or that dot line centerman's open. And again, it's a drill that goes end to end to end. Make sure you let it play out offensively. Make sure you're looking for that three-lane support with a dot line drive. Going to follow his play through the net, but we found that our guys get a lot out of this drill. We do it a lot. It really helps us become a better team in those situations that we just talked about. Next area I'd like to talk about is transition. And transition, to me, is important. The neutral zone, team that controls the neutral zone, usually dictates what end of the rink they're going to play. And I know Colorado is known as a really good offensive team, but of all the teams that I studied, they were the best team in the neutral zone. So I asked myself, well, they have a lot of skill, they have a lot of speed, they've done a great job, the staff done a great job, players buying in, they use that skill and speed as a checking tool to get the puck back, and then when they get the puck back, they do really good things with it. So some teams play a 1-2-2, these teams we're looking at play a 1-2-2. Some teams play a 1-1-3. To me, whatever you decide as a coaching staff that works for your group. I'm looking more at the offensive side of it. The one thing I will tell you, teams that play a 1-2-2 or a 1-1-3, the big thing is they want to control the middle of the ice so they can step up the challenge line. And that's where a lot of offense comes from. Colorado does a really good job of securing the middle of the ice, but I just want you to watch people off the puck and the effort to get to the net in these situations. They're all very good at it. I think Colorado is the best. See why they're a really good rush team. This is an F1 pressure. Again, if you look at the middle of the ice, taking care of a lot, he's got to step up. He turns the puck over. Now he's off to the races back the other way. Guy going through the net, stopping at the net. And a really good look from the offensive attack coming in on neutral zone play. They do a really good job of getting pressure on the puck. This is just a hinge rotation that they allow. We would do something very similar with Dallas. It allows that player to step up. Wants the player off the puck in his effort to get to the net. So where does effort come from? Where does offense come from? It's not hard to see when you watch these clips again and again. Vegas is another team that's very good in the neutral zone, another 1-2-2 team. But again, look at the middle of the ice. Because they have support in the middle of the ice, allows the defense to be aggressive. I think the one thing with Vegas that's really admirable is how their top guys are bought into the way their team wants to play defensively. Done a terrific job. Same thing with St. Louis. This is Schwartz. They are not aggressive outside the dots and they don't have that support in the middle of the ice. Let the forward get back. So now they do. You get a puck turned over, and I want you to watch the structure again. The dot line support, so they're trying to score on this guy. They have three lanes filled, which opens up the backside. And a guy going through the net. Really good look. This is Colorado against the Dallas Stars, unfortunately. They're able to hold the line, but again, what I want you to watch is just the structure off the line. Little guy's going through the net. Little guy wants to stop at the net. He creates that pocket underneath for that play to be made. And the one thing Colorado has is really highly gifted players, and I'm not saying we can all do this, but I just want you to look at the structure again. 1-2, three lanes filled. And Landeskog does it off the rest with just a great individual effort. It ends up making his play through the net. So, I'd say a look at transition for the teams that in our study that were really good in those areas. The tendencies that we saw was that a really good checking team they're really committed to. They're able to hold lines and turn pucks over in neutral, but they really had a good plan when that puck got turned over in terms of what they were doing. And I know they've got McKinnon and I know they got great players, but I think fundamentally they do some really good things in terms of down line support, always having a guy driving through the net. They're a really good stopping and staying around the net. So some of the things we do, when we do warm-ups in practice, try to incorporate a part of our game that's going to apply to game situations. So we do rush plays. This is Jimmy Montgomery's drill, but I'm sure he's not going to mind and I share it with him. We start this game 2-0, just drill 2-0, so forget about this guy for now. Two guys would leave off the same side, he would skate across, give a puck to the line, fill his lane. Second guy would layer himself, so he gets the puck underneath. You're going to drive, kick it out. You're going to drive wide, you're going to play out to the back post. On that drill, opposite corners will go, and both ends will go at the same time. When we get to the 3-on-0 portion of it, this is full speed. This guy leaves with a puck. This guy comes off his back, drops opposite to him. He's going to come up the middle. He's going to fill his lane. This guy's going to come with him. So you should have three guys come with speed in all three lanes. Sometimes we'll put coaches on the docks so we can just kind of force those plays a little bit and keep the guys in their lanes. But what we want to see on this drill is on the entry. Whichever way the puck gets kicked out, so if he kicks the puck out here, he's driving down the wall. We want him driving dot lane. Try and create that top line support to go with the defenseman there. The guy away from the puck, he wants to layer himself. So this guy's going to go through, and you're going to run all your options. You can make a chip play going through. You can make a play off the net where he's looking for a rebound, or you can let him clear out space, and he can make that play on the backside. The one thing I'd like to see on this drill is if this guy carries the puck to the top of the circle, this guy passes middle of the net. If he makes that play to the backside, this guy's passed more back post, so he's got that back post option. But it's a really good drill for speed, for touches, for end-to-end play, just to get some reminders in place of what you want to see off your team in terms of rush play. You want to cross and drop in there if you want to regroup with the other end. Those are all things you can add in there, but I just find you just break it down to the bare fundamentals of running your lanes and making plays off the net, your execution is going to improve some game time. Another drill that we use, and we call this duck shooting, you're probably a lot like me, where you have names for your drills. So you don't have to always go to the board. You can just reference the name of the drill. The guys know what it is. You can just pinpoint some of the fundamentals you're looking for and get off to the races so you're not wasting time at the board when you get on the rink or you can pre-ice before you get on the ice for practice. But one of my drills that we use quite often, both ends are going at the same time, so I just illustrate the one end. Two forwards can leave out of the same corner down here. On the whistle, with your puck spotted right here. This area right here. That's going to get hit that puck, he's going to drag it backwards, while those two forwards are going to clear the zone. So what you want is one guy opening up on the wall and one guy getting inside so he's a dot line support guy. What you don't want on this drill is two guys outside the dot. You want to have two options where one guy can't cover two. He's going to pass that puck up to the dot line guy, he's going to pick it out. Drive, you want this guy getting back for a shot off and now looking for a rebound. That defenseman now has to get up around the top. Now he's coming for a deep puck. Leave that puck where you see it. It's at the top of the circle. After those same two forwards make a play on that, they got to race back out of the zone for a second puck. But the same thing with a dot line and a guy headed to the wall. We want this guy to indirect that puck off the wall. We want this guy headed to the wall. We're seeing more and more of this in the National Hockey League. We call it just a quick up or an indirect to speed. Where as soon as you see possession, you're heading to the wall. You're looking for a little play off the wall where you can skate into it. But it makes your team play faster as opposed to waiting for a direct lane to open up to the receiver. This is something we've worked on a lot. Something our team's got a lot better at. Something I'd like to see us continue to improve at. They would take that second puck. Again, you would receive that puck. You would drive this guy to the net. To play off the net. That defenseman who made that second play up there, he's going to race up to the goal line. We're going to release. He can spot a puck from a goal. He goes low to high. Make sure one forward stays in net front. He's going to get out of the box. This guy's rolling into a high seam. And you're making a D shot off the net with the guy in net front. And the guy rolling off the wall looking for a tip, looking for a pass back, or looking for a rebound off the net. Opposite sides go at the same time. Obviously, you're going to run this drill. You're going to switch sides so you get reps on both sides. But when it's done right, it should be full speed, full tempo, and lots of action with lots of touches for your team. I hope you make it better in transition because I know it does for us. The drill that I use, it kind of ties everything together with the checking component. I call this track and attack. I think tracking is a new term. I know when I started playing, back checking was the term that was used for tracking, but now we all talk about tracking the hockey puck. So the way this would start would be with three guys, two defensemen and a forward here. We're going to skate and dump the puck in. Forecheck, that group of five, breaking the puck up. That forechecker is going to put pressure on the puck until it moves past the top of the circle. Then he's going to fall out of the drill. And that group, this group of five, is going to attack up ice 5-on-2. Let them play it out in the zone. Make sure you're looking for structure in terms of dot line support, making plays of the net. Good F3, D up on the line, all the things you want is a good offensive team. On the whistle, you have a player waiting over on the side with a puck below the hash mark. He's attacking up ice. Now those five offensive players have to track him down. And if the forward's above him, he can get him early. He's by them. The defense is going to slide over. the fours going to back check the belly ice. The whole idea here is to get that puck turned over as quickly as possible, get that puck up to forwards right away, have your D activate. Now you're attacking back on that defense again, and that forward is now back checking, so you're going to play it out 5 versus 3 in the zone. So it's got a lot of really good elements that tie in the checking component, being a quick team in transition. Got a little more resistance than what we've seen in the first couple of drills, and hopefully it makes your team better in this area, both from a breakout standpoint and from reacting in transition. Me, transition is changing direction quickly. Hopefully this is one of those drills that can help you in all those areas. Forecheck, this is I did this study, this is probably the one area that jumped out at me. Teams in the National Hockey League that can score the most are the best in this area. Tampa Bay is unbelievable at it. Boston Bruins are unbelievable at it. Pittsburgh Penguins are really good at it. So we're going to look at some tendencies on the teams that I studied and hopefully share with you guys some fundamentals on creating forecheck into more offense. St. Louis is one of the best in the league. I think they're worth talking about for Stanley Cup champions for a reason. This is probably the biggest strength in their game. The one thing we're looking at here is just the position in the puck battle. If you watch the St. Louis players, there's one guy on the wall. They never lose the second guy on the wall. This guy is very conscious of his position in the battle, so he doesn't get lost. Their third guy's discipline, outstanding. The third guy never gets lost below the puck. He's always in a position to support it. The one thing about forecheck, you can turn a puck over, you catch the other team out of position. And that's what I'm seeing in these forecheck runs. When you force a team to turn the puck over, teams that look to strike right away, create a lot of offense from it because the team's caught out of position. You see the same thing here with Colorado. You have two guys on the puck, good sticks. Discipline is the third guy not getting lost. He stays above it. He's able to get a puck turned over, and you're immediately looking to attack the net when people go on the net. You catch St. Louis out of position. The one thing I think you guys as coaches can really teach, this fundamental skill about finishing on top. You watch, and I know this is fault because the defenseman is on the forecheck. He finishes this guy on the wall, but he's making sure that he's beating the defensive player off the wall. He's looking to gain an advantage. Blaze comes in, same thing, beats his guy off the wall. Look at the discipline of the third guy. He stays above it. Now they force a turnover, and they're immediately looking to capitalize. They're out of position. They get to the net, and they score a big goal. A lot of offense in forecheck situations. I love this clip. O'Reilly's one of the better all-around players in the league. So just watch his position. Finishing on top. He rides the defenseman into the wall. Now he forces him on the wall. Gets separation off the wall. Now he's got the defensive player out of position. They're going to quick strike to the net. And they capitalize. Mark Stone, another terrific 200-foot player. See his angle. Stick on puck. See how he finishes on top. Never gets lost below the puck. He makes them play through. Again, now has to play through them. Puck's turned over. They're leaving the zone. They get caught out of position. Puck's in the back of the net. Another thing that's worth mentioning in terms of a forecheck is just your puck placement. Teams that are really good at forecheck are really good at puck placement. But the worst scenario they're trying to create on a puck placement is to create a 50-50 puck. When they can create a 50-50 puck, they got a chance for offense. They put a puck where it's 50-50 at least. They get on top of it. There's the body position. Always finish on top. Now they get a puck turned over. Chicago's leaving the zone. They get caught out of position. And the puck's in the back of the net. 50-50 puck. The first team I saw do this really well was Washington when Barry Trotz was there. They had a terminology that I used with the first touch of the net. They see success. They want to strike. And I think St. Louis does that as good as any team in the league. Just a great look at it. It's a great puck placement on a one-man forecheck. That's 1 versus 5. But because it's a 50-50 puck, he gets position. He's thinking first touch to the net, and the puck's in the back of the net. A lot of offense is coming out of this look. Colorado, look at that puck placement. It's a 50-50 puck. They go from breakout to D-zone coverage. They always have a guy in around the net. Puck's in the back of the net. Great look. Really good finish. You just see how important puck placement is. This is Vancouver. They're not putting a puck in to chase it. They're putting a puck in to keep it. fight for space, 50-50 puck, immediately looking to attack and strike the net. Just a great finish and a great play, all created from good puck placement. First touch mentality. I'm sure a lot of you coaches out there have offensive players, and you talk to them about offense, they're right away going to talk to you about their game with the puck. And part of my success in getting to offensive players is getting them to understand that it's a better position without the puck, they're going to have it more. And you're going to see that in these next few clips here. And when you put yourself in position to be on top, you make plays go through you, especially at the National Hockey League level, you're going to be in position for immediate offense. So the guy circled right there is pinned on the wall. When that puck goes east-west, he works to get off the wall, he gets across the top, and that's the guy that ends up with the puck. That's what you should be selling to your skilled players. You're in a better position. Defensively, they're going to have the puck a lot more to play offense. St. Louis is probably the best example in the National Hockey League of that philosophy. Turn right into offense, right back on the net. Same thing here. Wozak, pretty good offensive player. Eagles diving in right now. Lost. Stays above it. Forces a turnover. Puck comes back to him. Now instead of back checking, he's playing in the offensive zone. Who gets rewarded? Bozak. Just from being in good position. Another look at it. Schwartz, pretty good offensive player. Make sure he's above it. So we have possession. Forces a puck to come to him in the back of the net. So this whole posture, getting on top, staying above, really good. And this young Thomas player for St. Louis, great example. They've done a wonderful job with this kid. He's a highly talented, skilled player, but they had to work with him on the defensive part of the game and the staff. They're probably not happy where he is right now. He's cheating below the puck a little bit. But he recognized, I'm sure you can hear Groovy yelling in his ear right now, get out, get out. Cuts his route short. He gets above the puck. Gets it, you know. So it's just a great example of a young player getting on board. You turn a puck over, you get a chance to play in the offensive zone longer. You get to play the zone you'd much rather be playing instead of back checking. Vegas, really good team game. Just looking over there, getting over top, getting over top, getting over top. The thing you love about Vegas is even their fourth line guys, they want to make plays. They're a little bit different. They do a little more east-west movement, but very successful doing it. Same thing with Vancouver, you're just looking for tendencies. This is Bertanen off the puck. He gets above it. He never touches the puck, but he slows the exit down. Allows the guys down low to do the work, and the puck gets turned over and ends up in the back of the net. So, a really good look. By having a good third guy and trust in your third guy playing above the puck, allows you to involve your defense in your forecheck. In today's game, your defense has to be involved. Not forecheck with three guys at four. Having said that, I was really surprised when I did this study. I think that a lot more offense came out of D being involved, D pinching, D being aggressive. It extends zone time and contributes for sure, but I think it has to be an educated process because if you're put in play a gambler as a defenseman, you're probably going to give up too much the other way. But that trust and this defenseman coming down and forward getting back is critical to success in these situations. Again, St. Louis is really good at it. Defenseman comes down, you keep a puck alive. Now they turn with what's a puck leaving the zone to a puck in the back of the net. Really good job. But there has to be trust. Colorado's probably one of the more aggressive teams I saw in the league with their defenseman. He's coming down, so this forward's working his butt to get back. This defenseman's working to get down. There's a lot of trust in what they're doing. He knows he's going to cover for him. Puck comes right to him. Now they make a play going right back to the net that ends up being a goal off a forecheck situation. Just from having trust in each other. The other thing that happens when there's a real trust in D and the forwards and what they're doing, they're getting over top. And when they don't pinch, they want to stand in and hold the zone. Again, which allows them to extend zone time because they know that forward's committed to getting back. Instead of back checking all the way to their own zone, they're in the offensive zone. Looking for offense. They've really done a good job of getting them on board the way they want to play. The other thing some teams are doing, when there's no threat leaving the zone, we call it surf up. You guys maybe see some of this at your level as well. This guy's going to surf up, gap up on him right away. This is the young Gerard player, perfect young player. Now he gets rewarded with same thing with Vancouver. There's never surfing up on that guy leaving the zone. Never lets him leave. Again, extend zone time. Guy comes on line change. Easy goal in the back of the net. Last year, I want to talk about the teams that are really successful in this situation. This is probably the big thing that we picked up on. Just having an automatic out. So as soon as they have success on your forecheck, these teams that are good at it, they automatically know that there's somebody going to the dots. They're always looking for this guy in the dot. It's a soft area, it's tough to cover, and he gets a guy in great scoring position right away. Just want you to watch these clips. Just how automatic it is for these teams and how good they are and how much offense comes from it. Just been, it's terrific that they've been able to put this kind of structure in play. Again, St. Louis is one of the best. Puck is turned over. He doesn't even have to look. He's already looking for that guy in the dot. Boom, there he is. Puck in the back of the net. They've been doing it so well, it's almost an automatic with their eyes closed. There's the dot guy. He doesn't get the puck. He keeps the play alive. Goes to the backside. Puck comes around again. He's immediately looking for that guy in the dot. The thing is, when this guy's on the dot, it's a soft area. So who takes him? Does he take him? Does he take him? Does he come over here and take him? And if they do, they're going to free up this guy on the backside. And they do it really well. They spend a lot of time in the offensive zone, and they wear it out. Same thing with Vegas. Fairly similar mindset. There's a puck stopped up. Doesn't even look. Right away, looking for that guy in that soft area. Who's got him? He got him. He got him. He come up. Are you late? Too late. Puck in the back of the net. It's not just their top players. Obviously, a team-wide philosophy. There's a turnover. There's your dot line. There's big Ryan Reeves hammering a puck from the dot. And if you look at teams, why do they have success? They have a lot of the same tendencies. This is Vancouver. As soon as they see success, there's that soft area. Looking for him right away. Puck in the back of the net. So, me is a huge source of offense in your forecheck. There's a lot of things that come into play here, obviously, from a structured standpoint, but I think you as coaches at any level teach your players. What are you doing when you get there? Are you finishing on top? Are you in a good stick position? Are you working to get up? Are you reloading on top? D, are you getting up the ice and not being lazy? All of those things are coming into play. So I'm going to give you some of my drills here that we've used to work on forecheck. I know there's a million drills out there. Quite honestly, selfishly, I like to get your drills because there's never enough good drills. You always like to keep it fresh. These are some of the ones that we do. Get rid of the 3-on-1 part. The continuous breakout and forecheck. The way this drill is going to work, you're going to come out of the zone with five guys. You're going to dump the puck in. These five guys are going to dump the puck in here. And forecheck five guys back in the zone. And you're going to let that play out 5-on-5. If it turns over, let it play out a little bit. If they break out of the zone, forechecking team would fall out of the way, and it would be a 5-on-2 up the ice. They'd have success, play it out on the whistle. The offensive team drops out of the way. Team breaking out would break out 5-on-2 down the ice. Let them play it out in the zone. On the whistle, these guys are playing in the zone 5-on-5 versus 2. On the whistle, they turn up ice. They pass from a coach. Next five guys jump out. They are now going to forecheck. Next five guys at the other end. Try and get a turnover. Try and get a puck turned over one of the net. Team trying to break out. You're trying to have success. And all your fundamentals in terms of the team breaking the puck out. And it just goes end to end. The thing I would tell you in a lot of these drills, and certainly on this one, you have the luxury of having more than one coach on the ice. Separate the responsibilities. Have one coach watch the offensive side of the puck or the forecheck. And have one coach watch breaking out or the defensive side of the puck. If you're trying to watch both sides of the puck and making 10 adjustments all the time, the players aren't going to remember on any of it. You can try and drive home one or two key points on what you're working on that day, you're going to remember. If you don't have the luxury of having two coaches on the ice and you're by yourself, focus on one. Decide what you want out of the drill, and focus on that side of the drill. Because if you're going back and forth, you're going to be forever correcting things and saying you don't want to be a jack of all trades and master of none. Try and master a couple things on a drill. Try and get the most out of it. And then other drill that we do, this is more of a competition challenge. I've done this at every level. I've done it with kids. I've done it in the American Hockey League, and I've done it in the National Hockey League. So you can divide your team up into two teams. So you're going to actually have all your forwards and defensemen on the ice. The way this drill works is this. First time you go in the first round, would be a possession play. So the forwards are attacking straight out of neutral zone on a 3-on-2 rush. But you're just going to do top one. Forwards here are working with the defenseman down here in this goalie. So they would be on the same team. And you would play it out, and the point is awarded one of two ways. If the forwards go down and score, they get a point. If the defenseman, they have to skate the puck out of the zone. They can't shoot out of the zone. They have to skate it out of the zone. If the goalie makes a save and hangs onto the puck, he has to throw it to the defenseman, and they still have to skate out of the zone. And what this drill does is it really forces your forwards to finish on top. Really good stick check, with stick on puck. They have to pursue the puck all the time. And they're always trying to get above the puck, above the puck, above the puck. And the defenseman, it's good for them too, because instead of just throwing the puck away, they got to protect it, they got to support each other, they got to try and skate to open space. So if either team has success, the ball right away, and you're awarded the point to either the team that scored or the defenseman that skated the puck out of the zone. You stop the drill and you restart it again. The second part of the drill is you would chip it in and recover it as opposed to attacking with a possession. And it's a really good drill. It's a really competitive drill. You've done right. The forward should be on top all the time. For some reason, the defensemen always have a lot of success in this drill. I've done this drill with NHL players where I made the losing team buy the winning team an ice cream cone on a road trip. And you'd be amazed at how painful it is for guys to dig in their pocket the money to pay for an ice cream cone with the other guy chirping them on the other side. So good team builder as well, but it's one I really like. It's one I use a lot. The last area I want to talk about is just ozone play. And ozone play would be just full-time possession in the ozone, hanging out of the puck, as opposed to getting a puck turned over and turning into offense. I just want you to share this same study I did with L.A. When I took over L.A. as a head coach, we didn't score very much. We went from 4-1 239 in the year. If you look at the bottom, our special team is kind of the same as it has. That wasn't where we made improvement. We improved 38 goals in 1 year without any personnel changes. Matter of fact, we lost Jeff Carter that year to a tendon injury early in the year. But we improved by 38 goals, mostly due to our 5-on-5 play. A lot of it came out from the same study I just shared with you that I did with the Dallas Stars. And what we found with the Los Angeles Kings, forecheck, we were actually pretty even. We improved by 10 goals in ozone play, and we improved by 13 goals in neutral play. Just looking at those fundamentals, looking at those areas, getting a better attack, more focus on a top line driver going in net, we got way, way better at it. We improved our scoring. We had a big year that year in terms of the team, and 98 points to make the playoffs after missing the year before. So I felt that study really helped us. We did that here. We brought on board Donnie Nockbar and Dave Lowry, who coached the Western Hockey League. We really challenged our team to find areas where we could get better at. So we just, instead of getting complicated, we broke it down into simple areas. In simple areas, we broke it down, number one, net front. We want to make sure we establish a net front presence right away in the offensive zone. We've always been known as a team in Los Angeles that had the puck a lot. We were always top five in the league in possession. When we were bottom five, chances created in the offense. We knew we had to change that. What do we have to do? We had to get people inside. We had to get people in the slot, people at the net, more plays inside. We demanded a better net presence. And it really helped us. So that was the foundation of our game plan. We had people go on the net. The other thing we talked about was this guy right here. I'd always refer to this guy as F3. So we sat down as a staff and F3 is not working for us. F3 always is considered so how do we change the mindset? Well, let's call him Trigger. He's thinking about being a shooter. And we got to start thinking about being in good position, but thinking about being an offensive threat. We found, as you saw in those other clips, that guy right there was in the best offensive posture in the ice. It was a soft area that was tough to cover. So by having that guy there, we opened up a lot of space. We opened up the defense, still made sure we had people going to the net, and it really helped us. Really helped us. So just a simple focus from our hockey team. We ended up putting a guy inside a lot more, so we had people inside the dots, and we weren't spending our time outside the dots all the time. You see it here is again, our trigger coming down from above. There he is. Play inside, play to the back of the net. allowed us to use the top of the zone, and we never went away from that concept of having a foundation, being a really competitive team around the front of the net. The other area I wanted to focus was using the back of the net more. You find teams that are really good offensively when they don't have an out. They always have that escape to the back of the net where they can maintain possession. Now they get into puck protection, which we'll talk about more in a minute. It's a really important offensive part of the game. We allowed our defensemen to be really active. Being a Drew Doughty there, just a terrific all-around player. Again, terrific net presence there. Just a really good fundamental we focused on that really helped our hockey team improve. Kopitar, one of the best puck protection guys in the league. By having people inside, we spread our defense. Now we have two guys inside the dots. We look for layers going to the net. A lot of things come out of that simple structure of our hockey team. Making sure we have people in the middle. Making sure that we have people going through the net. If you look at this clip here, we've got three guys inside the dots. Opens up a play to the backside. Allows the puck in the back of the net. So it really, really helped us. Now the drill I'll share with you here. It's called the Snack Bar. Don Knockbar's nickname was Snack, so this was his drill. We loved it. Trying to pound home a lot of the same concepts I was just sharing with you there. So the way the drill worked, and it's really worked out at one end. The drill will start down here at this end, and in two parts of the drill, and then the third part will be at the far end. But we ran this drill out of one end, so we had two forwards right here starting below the goal line with a defenseman in front. On the whistle, they made a pass behind the net, just to encourage those plays below the goal line. We attacked 2-on-1. On the whistle, we threw a puck over to the side. The third guy in the line would get that puck, and he had to rim it to the back of the net, create that roll to the back of the net, so we're changing the point of attack. And this guy would come down from above, and the new defenseman would join in. So now we play it out 3-2. And play it out with all those concepts, somebody at the net, somebody in the slot, somebody rolling away, trying to get off the wall. Whistle would go. Coach would throw a puck to the back of the net, and now forward. With the defensive board, if you follow me down to the other end now, he would jump in and we would play it out 3-on-3 with more resistance. It was really good in all those elements, puck protection, back of the net, trying to get out front, fighting for space at the net. The main thing was that defensive board, we made him carry a puck in his hand. And the reason we made him carry a puck in his hand is so he kept his stick on the ice in the defensive board. Donnie B always tried to keep picking his stick up, he couldn't get him a puck in his hand. We played out 3-on-3. As soon as the whistle went, pull me back the other end. He would take that puck in his hand with him below the goal line. He'd drop it. The new guy in his line would jump in there with him. New defenseman would jump in and start all over again. 2-on-1, 3-on-2, 3-on-3. And it's just a really good drill for us in terms of the concept we were trying to put in place. We call it Snack Bar. They knew what it was. It had really good feed in it. Really good puck protection. Really good for both sides of the puck. Quite honestly, we're looking at the defensive side of the puck. And I really thought it helped our team improve in a lot of areas offensively. Just finishing up on bringing it a little more modern. That was a few years ago in L.A. The research I did this year on the team that I've mentioned in terms of offense and zone play, there's two areas that jumped out at me I want you guys to focus on. Net front presence, puck protection. And the teams here, that a lot of their offense has good movement. A lot of their offense is more complicated than just those two things. Their offense, the foundation of their offense and movement is based on those two fundamentals. And I think any team and any player can better those things. And that's the thing that jumped out at me. So if you watch St. Louis, O'Reilly at the net, he's holding net front. There's that automatic out. There's nothing going on. He rolls to the back of the net. DJ puts his guy in his back. What I love about this clip, they end up with three different guys at net front. So now there's second guy going to net front. No play. He's automatic out to the back of the net. Now Perron ends up at net front. There's O'Reilly over here. So they really do a good job of creating triangles offensively. They're really tough on the puck. Now watch O'Reilly here. His discipline to stay as an F3, just like they did on the forecheck, is outstanding. They pay too much attention to him. That opens up Pedranzo on the backside. Really good look. Another look at it off a faceoff. There's no play. They automatically know they can go to the back of the net. Just want you to watch this puck protection here. You're creating space off the wall, getting into the guy's hands, putting him on his back. Protect, protect, protect. Look at the net front. Two guys fight to get to the net, back to the net. Here's O'Reilly again. play to the goal line. A lot of teams are running this three high look. But now watch. A lot of players right now, they would skate this part here. But Riley's first step is here. He wants to get inside this guy and gain a favorable position before that player can adjust his defense. He goes right inside his arms. Just look at the battle at net front. Puck protection, net front. Load of high play, people going to the net. Here's O'Reilly again. Not going to the hole. Not going here. He's going here. Put him on his back. Put him on his back. Put him on his back. Rolls off. Now they get two guys going to the net. Play in the back of the net. Really good look. Talked about this Thomas earlier. No play. Now he's holding on to it. Puck protect allows defenseman to activate. Puck protect. Here's your pop guy. Puck in the back of the net. Vegas, really good at it. Puck protect, net presence. Puck protect. One thing Vegas does differently, they do a lot of east-west plays. They're always looking to make an east-west pass, shot off the pass. They're very good at it. Here's your pop play again, a little puck protection, back of the net. Another look at it. Top player, Smith. Puck protect. Puck protect. Now you got players going on the net. Now you got movement off your D, and there's that east-west movement again that they're so good at. Catches a lot of teams by surprise. This top line is fun to watch. This is a great clip to learn from. There's your dot line guy. Now, most teams, they want to come towards this guy. With Vegas, they don't. They're expecting him to make a play. They're expecting him to protect the puck. So instead of coming out of scoring positions, these guys are going to go in the scoring position. They're counting on Carlson to make a play. It's off the wall. Makes a play inside. Little touch pass. Back of the net. The last team we'll talk about here is Colorado. Colorado does a ton of this three high look. So they're going to spread you out with three high in the zone. Once they get three high in the zone, I want you to just watch what goes on in net front. You got two guys going on the net. They spread you out, and they beat you inside. Puck protection is still a big part of their game plan. There's some highly competitive offensive players that want to protect the puck and hang on to it. There's your guys going through the net. Three high, two at the net. Branton, another great young player, protected. Makes a play up top. There's your three high. McKinnon, he's going to skate away. Let's look at the separation. This is phenomenal. They get this three high look. Here's your three high with activate your defense. Going on net front. Guys at net front. So they do a really good job at it. They got a little bit of a different scheme there, but I think those fundamentals are really key to their success. When they puck protect, they hang on to it. See McKinnon now, he's going to run his three high look. Allows that spread look. He's going to hang on to it. And there's your two guys at net front again. Putting the puck there and winning a battle at net front. So sometimes I think as coaches we overcomplicate it. I think it's good to have options, work on set routes, support plays. But I think if you can target some fundamentals for your players, especially young players, it's going to make you a much better team. Probably you spend a lot more time in the zone and build it from there. The drill we use to work on this is a drill that I love. It's got all those elements we talked about. Again, I would do this drill half-ice. I think it's good when your whole team's watching. It creates a really competitive environment. Again, you might want to have one coach watching. Players defensively, you want to have one coach watching your players offensively. So, coach would be here with pucks. You have a defenseman in the floor in a corner, and you have a throw puck in here, and play this out one on one. Whistle goes, they would rest. Let's throw a puck over here. And play this out two on two with two forwards of the same color, and a D, another defenseman, and a defensive forward. And then on the whistle, you would throw in a third puck, and you'd all join together, and you play it out three on three on the zone. All three pucks, the one-on-one, the two-on-two, and the three-on-three, they have the option of a load of height as a defenseman to try and beat your guy off the wall to the net. Now they're looking for shot tip pass, they're looking for plays in the net, being booked up, net front battle. Same thing with the two-on-two, same thing with the three-on-three. For the purpose of the drill, we don't allow the D to activate. We're just looking for that puck protection, back of net plays, load of height, winning races to the net. Something that works really well for us, something we do often. Tell you a quick story. I had a kid that played for me when I was coaching in the American League with the Phantoms. His name was Ben Stafford. We won the Cup in 05. He retired after that year. here and went to medical school, and dropped out of medical school after a year and became an officer in the Marine Corps. He gave me this book, it was called Passion of Command. And in this book, it stated that the best asset for a young soldier was basic training. Basically, what they were saying was, they strive to be brilliant in the basics. When they got into battle and they got under heated conditions, they could really count on their fundamentals. One coach to another, I would strongly urge and challenge you, try and pinpoint fundamentals in all aspects of your game, try and be brilliant in the basics. So the things we talked about today, exits, fundamentals for me in those exits, knee retrieval. What do you teach going back for bucks? What are they doing on the first time? Do they just throw it around the wall? Are they passing the ball down to somebody else? Are they working to stay connected to the play when it leaves the zone? Are they doing a good shoulder check? That angle, false information. Is your centerman working as a top line support guy? How important is role play to your players? It should be critical, and you should work on it all the time. There's a neutral zone. There's lots to talk about here. Depending on what your scheme is in terms of checking, but depending on what's important, gap, you stick your angles. Teaching forward angling, stick detail. Just puck movement. Execution of puck movement. You know, I was sloppy passes. The guy just put pucks on the wall and getting out of the point and make a play. You have good habits on the rush in terms of what you want. You might want stack it. You want one more cross and drop. Whatever it is, find out what the fundamentals that you can teach and make sure your team is really good at. What was on forward check? You got to start thinking about forward check as offense and not defense. If you say F3 and forward check, they think, okay, we're checking. We're not. We're trying to create offense. Pursuit and angle. Body position, the idea of finishing on top. If he's surfing, what are you teaching there with angles and stick position? You want your knee pinching, how do you want to pinch it? You figure out what it is and make sure you teach it. I think it's important at every level. Doesn't matter if we're talking youth sports or National Hockey League, I think we have to be able to teach them. Who's on the fundamental? Knee, break it down. You can teach movement in all these complex schemes, but you got to be able to execute. No different than a power play. You have to have good execution. You have to know the play pass. You have to know the pass. Puck protection means you should work on it all the time. Catch and release skills. You know, to get that puck on and off your tape, including one time, means it's critical. Net front detail. Not just about going in front of that stand. What are you doing? You're taking the goalie's eyes away. You're fighting for position. You're making your stick available. All stuff that you as a coach should find a way to teach. And your blue line movement. When I was in Los Angeles, our name every year in the top five in offense, even though we weren't an offensive team, we worked on our blue line shooting movement every day, every game day. And we demanded it from our players. The year we won the Cup in 14, we tied a National Hockey League record with 19 goals for defense. Huge part of our success. Lastly, I'll leave you with this. Bob Clark is a huge influence in my hockey career, both as a player and a coach. And I was coaching in Philadelphia. He used to always come in. We would talk hard. Of course, if any coach I would be complaining about. Guy doesn't practice hard enough. He doesn't back check hard enough. He's not competitive enough now and then. He just looked at me and he laughed. He said, John, just remember, the player is going to accept what you accept. If you accept the lazy line chain, so what? If you accept the lazy back check, so what? If you will accept the player not being competitive, so what? If you don't, you won't. And I never forgot that. And I, indebted to pass it on because it really resonated with me. So hopefully you've enjoyed what we've had to present today. Probably a little different because we tried to cover the whole zone. It's really been a treat having you here. I appreciate you guys taking the time. I think the Coast Association's done a great job. I really appreciate that. I wish you guys all safe health.